This is the first of three videos on non-diagonalizable matrices. In this one, we're going to see how you can use perturbations of the matrices together with everything we know about diagonalizable matrices to understand the non-diagonalizable case. Let's recap what we already know. We already know that a matrix is diagonalizable if the geometric multiplicity equals the algebraic multiplicity for every single eigenvalue. We also know that the geometric multiplicity is trapped somewhere between 1 and the algebraic multiplicity. So, if all the algebraic multiplicities are 1, all the geometric multiplicities are 1, and it's diagonalizable. In other words, if the characteristic polynomial has distinct roots, we win. And most polynomials have distinct roots. If you take any polynomial, even if it's got a double root or a triple root or a hundredth order root, and you add a small constant to it, you get a polynomial with distinct roots. So what we're going to do is we're going to perturb our polynomial, perturb our matrix, and that's going to perturb the polynomial, give it distinct roots, and then we're going to use diagonalization. So if somebody gives us a non-diagonalizable matrix and gives us a problem that you have to solve, you know, it might be a differential equation, might be a difference equation, might be just finding a power of the matrix. You know, if you have some problem involving a non-diagonalizable matrix, the game is we're going to find a diagonalizable matrix that's close to the non-diagonalizable one. You know, by adding epsilon to some of the entries, we're going to get a matrix that's diagonalizable. And then we can diagonalize it. We can write it as PDP inverse, where P and D and P inverse depend on epsilon. And then we solve the problem in terms of A epsilon. Now that isn't exactly a solution. We have to use A, so we take a limit as epsilon goes to zero. And typically, when you take epsilon goes to zero, something's going to go wrong, because you couldn't just take epsilon equal to zero, because that would have been non-diagonalizable. So typically, you wind up with something that looks like zero over zero, or maybe one to the infinity, or some other indeterminate form. And you resolve that using L'Hopital's rule. So here's our example. Somebody gives us this, our standard example of a non-diagonalizable matrix, and asked us to find the nth power of that matrix. Now, in this case, you could actually find the nth power, in more elementary ways, but we want to demonstrate the method. And so let's take a look at the method here. We're going to look at the matrix not 1, 1, 0, 1, but 1, 1, some really small number 1. So in terms of epsilon, we're going to put an epsilon squared here. And that makes the determinant 1 minus epsilon squared. And the trace is still 2. So the eigenvalues are 1 plus epsilon and 1 minus epsilon. They add up to 2, and their product is 1 minus epsilon squared. And you can work out what the eigenvectors are. They're 1 epsilon and 1 minus epsilon. So that means that we can factorize our matrix as P, D, P inverse. P, the columns of P are our eigenvectors. And then we can write the nth power of the matrix as P, the nth power of D, P inverse. And now we work out what the inverse of this matrix is. It's minus 1 over 2 epsilon. The determinant is negative 2 epsilon, and then you swap the minus epsilon and the 1, and you flip the sign of the 1 and the epsilon. So there's the inverse. And we're going to absorb the minus signs here into here. Okay, and then we just multiply it out. This term times this gives you some expressions involving 1 plus epsilon to the n and 1 minus epsilon to the n, and you finish multiplying the whole thing out, and you wind up with this mess. Okay, it's a mess. If you want a finite value of a non-zero value of epsilon, this is very messy. But taking the limit as epsilon goes to zero is easy. The limit here is 1 to the n plus 1 to the n over 2. That's just 1. The limit here is 0 times 1 minus 0 times 1 over 2. That's 0. The limit here is 1 plus 1 over 2, that's 1. The only tricky one is in this corner, where the numerator goes to 0 and the denominator goes to 0. That's our 0 over 0 situation. And we use L'Hopital's rule on it, and we get n. So there we go. We solved our problem. Now, this was, you know, a particularly simple example of a matrix. In general, we'll have to be a bit more creative in finding perturbations, but the whole idea is the same. Bump the matrix a little bit to get something diagonalizable, solve the problem using diagonalization, then take epsilon goes to 0, and use L'Hopital's rule whenever you're stuck with something that looks like 0 for 0.